Today is August 27th, 2015, and it is my pleasure to be speaking this morning with Jim Sitzman. Jim has a long career in Oregon land use, including time at Metro and its predecessor, the Columbia Region Association of Governments, where he assisted in drawing the first urban growth boundary around the metropolitan area. He's also been a longtime field representative for the Department of Land Conservation and Development. Jim holds degrees from Willamette University and Harvard Divinity School. My name is Kevin Pozzi, and I'm the program manager here at Planning Oregon, which is a new program within the College of Urban and Public Affairs at Portland State University. Jim, we're honored that you'd be willing to sit down with us today and are hoping to gather as much information as we can from the people who are influential in forming and shaping Oregon's land use system. We're aiming to document the stories, anecdotes, and experiences of people who were involved back then, as well as to get your thoughts on how the system has evolved and where you think it might be headed today. So we encourage you to share anything you feel is relevant, and I'm ready to begin. So as we start, I was hoping that you could touch on your personal and professional relationship with Oregon's land use system.
Sure. I had my start at the old Columbia Region Association of Governments, which, as you've indicated, later became Metro. The urban growth boundary was actually concluded under the jurisdiction of Metro, the transition having occurred while we were laboring to get it put together. And I guess my background is kind of unusual in that I had no formal training, still have no formal training in the various subjects that inform urban planning or land use planning in general. I had been recruited to the Columbia Region Association of Governments, CRAG, to do regional social service planning. And I was there just a few months when the City of Portland representative changed with Neil Goldschmidt's election as mayor. And as those who remember Mr. Goldschmidt will attest to, he was a pretty dynamic personality, and it didn't take long for him to persuade the director at CRAG that the agency ought to spend what few chits it had on land use and transportation and not get further into social services planning. So that left me kind of hanging there, observing what was going on, and then in the meantime, the staff of the planning department came out with its red book, as it was familiarly called, a large document that set forth a regional plan for the Portland area. And it had, from my understanding, a limited amount of input in its production from local government officials or planners. And so when it was popularly distributed around the region and people began absorbing it, there was a large hue and cry against it, that the region was trying to usurp too much local authority, et cetera, et cetera. And to make a long story short, the aftermath of that, the director of that department left the organization. His assistant was put in interim position, but he left shortly after for a vacation. He went to Findhorn in Scotland to try to find himself following the divorce that he'd had, and came back, worked a week, and came in the following Monday and resigned. So that left the director with me sitting on the sideline, and one of his two major departments without any leadership. And so he asked me to do an interim, and the upshot of that was that it coincided with the need for Metro to begin orienting its program, planning program, to the state Senate Bill 100 program. And so our first assignment, while I was doing an interim stint, was to draw up regional goals and objectives, which were largely patterned after the state goals and objectives. And then to commence work on the metro urban growth boundary, the law having been changed recently to assign to CRAG that responsibility rather than doing 27 city boundaries in the metro area. So I'd launched into that, and I eventually became the permanent director of the department and followed the process through. And I would just observe about that, that I think what made that work was the fact that I had had a history in working in group work type activities with the Portland YMCA, had a communications degree background, had my degree work indicated I had some ability intellectually to comprehend subject matter, and that combination I think became very useful because with the Red Book experience and there having not been much collaboration, that was really necessary getting into the UGB and the goals and objectives work. So my talents were to work with committees and staff, to communicate to boards and committees, to public groups, and that combination of my skills put together with 10 to 15 staff people with a wide diversity of backgrounds in planning, I think made a good combination. At least we got through the exercise and the boundary is eventually acknowledged by the state.
Yeah. And we could talk more about your experiences with the LCD maybe at a different point in the interview. But I was hoping, you know, while we're back at that topic, what did you personally hope to accomplish in carrying out SB 100?
Well, I think having gotten into it the way I did, part of it was just survival.
Yep.
You know, and I recognize this was, what I'm about to say was kind of awareness that accumulated over time. But but I think a couple of things that stand out was the, I recognized in the goals the opportunity to steward natural resources and human resources of the region. That became pretty evident with the emphasis on goal five, natural resources, air, water, land quality kinds of issues. So that stewardship motivation, I think, was part of it. But I also became kind of fascinated by the fact that we were crafting a rational habitat.
I like that phrase.
I'm sorry?
I like that phrase.
Yeah. I think as we go on here, I want to emphasize some of the comprehensive nature of the planning program that was set down by Senate Bill 100. And that comprehensiveness became exciting as you looked at inventories, you looked at the lay of the land, the extent of existing development versus undeveloped open space areas, and as you were considering all those kinds of those facts, it became evident that we were shaping the habitat for the region, and that was important to me.
And do you feel satisfied that those hopes were realized?
Satisfied maybe is a little over the top. I do feel that we are fortunate in this region for having done the planning that we've done. I often think about, you know, driving from Portland to Boise and crossing over the border and seeing for all those miles into Boise, the rural landscape fractured by subdivisions and both residential and industrial, and things kind of a hodgepodge of growth and development. I was born, though not raised, in Colorado in the Denver area, outside of Denver, and the same thing is evident when you drive around that part of that state. And so, the fact that we can still go from Portland to Eugene, and you see cities, but they're confined to their locale, and the intervening spaces are pretty rural and pretty agricultural and pretty oriented to forestry activities, and that's satisfying. So I think by and large we've been favored by what we've done, and we'll get into, I'm sure, down the line here, but I think there are some danger signs that we need to be cognizant of too.
Well, we'll get to the danger in a little bit, but as you're fully aware, LCDC adopted 19 statewide goals, and I'm wondering which you feel maybe were most important to the accomplishments of the program, and maybe which ones hadn't held up.
Well, no surprise. I think goal 14 was probably among the goals, probably the chief one. It's a little hard for me to be too selective on that, however, because I think the real value is in that comprehensiveness again. Mm-hmm. I put goal 14 on top because of all the single goals, that's the one that is most comprehensive. We spend a lot of time in doing the boundary, doing inventories, mm-hmm, of all the various elements represented by the various goals. And when we started drawing lines, they were informed by good information. When we started estimating quantities of land for housing and industry and so forth, there was an understanding behind that of the economy of the area, the types of employment that are endemic to the area and that were reasonable to expand upon, the kinds of housing that both the region already had a lot of and the kinds that it lacked, mm-hmm, because we not only knew single family versus multifamily and types of multifamily in their quantities and so forth, but there was a correlation to income that was related to being able to afford different kinds of housing. Mm-hmm. So it was a comprehensive, complex enterprise that we had to go through. And interestingly, that we're really started to break down, I think, in my mind, was that the technique that we used in that process was to take the statewide goals, frame them into more simplified language, send them out to all the cities and counties, and said, in your area of jurisdiction, send us back a map showing where you think these goals, if applied properly, would result in an urban growth boundary for your city. And they were later taken out of our jurisdiction, but North Plains, that you mentioned, mm-hmm, a few moments ago, came back with a map that had its urban area going all the way out to the hills to the north of the city, a massive, massive area. And so that we started bringing that in, and then when they were taken out of our jurisdiction, LCDC, in working with them, greatly shrunk that. One of the real areas of controversy was in the Beaverton area, where Beaverton had gone over a mountain or a hill ridge line and had large acreage on the back side, which took it out of the existing sewer system. And so we began piecing together the kind of the cost and environmental, both fiscal costs and environmental costs of opening up a whole new drainage basin to accommodate typical sewer systems, or the cost elements involved in pumping large quantities of sewage into the existing drainage basin. So there was that kind of comprehensiveness again that was present in our activity, and so 14 it gets my top billing.
Are there others that you're admirer of?
Obviously, 3 and 4, the farm and forest, because of the significance of those two industries to the state economy, particularly at that time. There's been shifts in the last 40 years, 45 years, in the region's economy, but statewide, ag and forestry were and still are very significant. I remember one incident that really brought this home sharply. The mayor of Hillsboro and a couple other Washington County officials asked for and received an opportunity to sit down and talk with the DLCD director and the director of the Department of Agriculture. And of course we know that Hillsboro sits in a very productive agricultural region. They kept sidling up to the point that they were concerned about and why so much restriction was being placed on them as to, where they could grow and develop. One of them made the observation that you got all this land in eastern Oregon, you got water in the Columbia, farm over there. And Bruce Andrews, who was the director of the Department of Agriculture, finally says in direct response to that question, 252. And they said, what do you mean? He said, your area, because of the fertility of the soil and the water availability, is capable of producing 253 different products, different crops. And that provides farmers with their large investments a lot of flexibility depending on changes in the market from year to year, or decade to decade, or climate issues, kind of stuff. So that it's a very critical part of the agricultural economy. Other things, well document the importance of forestry in that same regard. So I guess those two probably, putting some tight controls and statewide regulation on farm and forest activity were very important. And then I guess the last one I would single out is goal one on citizen participation. Mm-hmm. And I think even from my experience here doing some of the interviews, it highlighted for me again the fact that particularly at the onset of this program, citizen involvement was very, very important. Both in developing some understanding of what Senate Bill 100 is all about, giving a very thorough airing to the proposed goals, statewide goals and objectives, the fact that the DLCD staff was bundled up and put in their vehicles and taken all over the state with their charts and maps and
security issues, I've heard as well.
Yeah, So that came out of Goal 1, Citizen Involvement, propelled that kind of effort and was really important in building a constituency for the program and develop some understanding. And I think looking back at it, we can credit the survival of three different ballot measures against the program to that solid work that was done to involve the public. And not only the effort that emanated from the department itself, but then as the jurisdictions started doing their planning and they had their citizen involvement committees and processes and the state review process of their planning wasn't looking only at the substantive issues, but also the processes that were being used and the extent to which citizens were brought into it. That also built that kind of constituency, and I think it's not going too far to say that the trajectory of that being very high at the beginning and has kind of had its highs and lows and is probably ebbing at this point. I think citizen involvement goal is still active at the local level when they're doing a periodic review or they're doing a plan amendment or they're reviewing a major development project. There's still that structure in most instances readily available for citizen public input, but there's not the energy and the massiveness that once was there. But.
And do you think that's because the goal is less relevant today? I mean, we've figured out how to do this, or is it because we have to, change our processes for a different generation?
I think it's more the latter. Some of it's a matter of familiarity. At the beginning, it was a matter of inventing some of these committees and processes and so forth, and experimenting with different things. But once certain styles and practices became familiar and beneficial, you kind of stay in that. But I do think the social media type era that we're in now means not only a difference in the environment for citizen involvement at this point, but it opens up a whole host of new opportunities if some entity, some people really put their minds to it and try to apply various social media resources to kind of breathing some new life into the program, that would be very, very beneficial. And I think it's kind of necessary at this point too. I was struck by conversation recently with a very strong advocate from the beginning of the state program, and in the conversation talking about their contribution and what they saw happening at that time, there were repeated references to density that they're experiencing in their neighborhoods. They were very conscious of a unexpected consequence of the land use program that they had been champions of, they were not really comfortable with.
What aspects of density do you recall
What aspect of
that they were uncomfortable with?
Residential primarily, but I think it also tripped over into transportation issues. And in fact, on the news yesterday, there was a story about Portland being at the top, or at least near the top, of the metropolitan areas around the country with traffic congestion. Actually, I think in that traffic congestion, we were down in the 9th or 10th spot, but it was also noted in a related news item about the fact that Portland is one of the largest recipients, one of the recipients of the largest influx of population, and some of it was being kind of tied back to the climate issues, people getting out of wherever, and made me think of the travels that I've done in the last 15 years, both to the east and to Europe. I always come back to Oregon and say, you know, I've just experienced a lot of beautiful, wonderful places around the world, but Oregon is still very fresh and very special. And when I listen to the news all winter about 7-foot snowbanks in Boston, et cetera, et cetera, Oregon is kind of a special place. And some of my notes were, you know, get into this a little bit later, but it seems to me that we have a lot to lose. And if we take it too much for granted, we could start losing it.
Well, just going back real quick, are there any goals that you feel like maybe haven't lived up to what they had originally intended? Maybe, you know, there were certain goals that just haven't accomplished what they had originally hoped? And
Well, I would guess that the air, water, and land quality issues, we're probably not harmed too much in that regard because we've had a strong DEQ over the years, but I'm not sure we've exacted all the benefit at the land use planning side of things to have achieved as much as we might have in those areas. I guess I would make a similar observation regarding wetlands. It's still a little bit too easy. I haven't been a constant watcher of this in recent years, but it's been a little bit too easy to convert a wetland or to pipe it, kind of thing. And it's, you know, at least we've kind of gotten past the point where a lot of people think of a wetland as a swamp. It's a negative connotation, but I'm not sure we have the level of appreciation about the value and the function of good wetland systems. Metro has, I think, helped in some regards in some of the purchases they've made. I happen to live in an area where there's a very large wetland that they purchased as part of their open space parks program and are working to protect and upgrade that wetland facility. And it's really kind of rewarding to come down the hill and see the wetland with still a lot of water, even under the circumstances of the hot temperatures this year. So some things are happening, but I just have this feeling that across the public, generally speaking, they still are not appreciated and protected to the extent that they should be. Mm-hmm.
Are there any policies or subjects that you feel like LCDC should have addressed in the goals that they did not? whether at the time or looking, you know, in hindsight?
Well, yeah, a lot of it's kind of hard to avoid in hindsight, but it's valuable to us also. I guess one of the things that keeps me a little discontent about how successful we've been in this program is that, and this is a generalization, and people can find exceptions to it, but it seems like we've kind of fenced in the idea of planning. It's one thing to plan, it's another thing to see that those plans executed. And to some extent, that is by the state, through periodic review and so forth, making sure that the counties still have active and land use plans and that they're using them, and that the processes have been set up to make decisions based upon those plans. The area where I think we were deficient is being more introspective about what those plans mean and what it takes to realize or to accomplish what those plans intended. The density issue, I think, may be factors into this a little bit. Talking about citizen involvement and maybe needing to refresh and upgrade public awareness of the program and all. Density doesn't come about by accident, and it's not altogether bad or inappropriate. I think Metro has been very insightful in its regional plan in trying to emphasize development, mixed-use development, emphasize development in the station areas and central cities, sort of thing, tying density in activity, whether it's residential, or commercial, or industrial, or a culmination, and tying that to the transportation system. It makes little sense running a max line from one oasis to another with a lot of desert in between. Speaking in those terms, apply about to the urban environment. So it makes even less sense to run transit around to places of low density population. I think we need to, on the citizen side, do more to educate and develop awareness about that. And on the execution side of it, to do more to stimulate the kinds of development that makes sense in that sense. I recall when we got the state's acknowledgement of the urban growth boundary, Rick Gustafson, who was the executive of Metro at that time, immediately started to downplay. In fact, part of his message to LCDC going through acknowledgement was, don't send it back to us again. Our resources are limited and we've got to get on to some other things. But his notion, which I think was right on, his notion was that Metro needed to shift from almost a total emphasis on the planning and begin to exert its influence in stimulating development in places where it made sense according to these plans and the goals to develop. And with that philosophy, he also said bye, Jim, and I was out of a job. And one of the last things I did at CRAG was to work with Rick to recruit somebody who had had experience in stimulating in public-private manner development in chosen locations. And Phil Whitmore came to the region and spent some time at Metro and many more years at TriMet, where he was working on stationary development. There was an old ODOT building at 60th and Gleason, just up the bank from the Max Line, and that property was converted into a several story residential project, a lot of it oriented to senior citizens. I've noticed just recently in Hillsboro a property that Phil had acquired for the region through some of the funds that were available to him. It was an old bank building. The property just in the last year or so has developed, and this is downtown, right downtown Hillsboro, a sprawling low-rise. This is a four, five, six-story apartment condominium facility that takes kind of an L shape around two corners of a block. And that all came because we had somebody in the region that, but there's been very little of that compared to business as usual. You know, I guess one of my observations would be that if nothing else, we could be nurturing more Rudy Cadlubs behind the rental station project. We could be recruiting and training, if you will, more people like that to take on significant projects that could change the region.
So based on Senate Bill 100, the statewide planning goals were drafted to express the state's policy interests in local land use planning. Do you believe LCDC acted correctly to ensure that these objectives have been carried out?
Yes, by and large. I guess I have one observation that they maybe, in many instances, exercise too much patience with jurisdictions that were dragging their feet or not really putting the resources necessary to get the job done, with extension after extension after extension, and to some extent that probably was useful in that some children are harder to train, and you gotta go through iterative processes and try different methods, different techniques. So I think to some extent that was of necessity, because the commission had to always have at least one eye towards the legislature, not create a lot of decision makers who were in opposition to the program because their local jurisdiction or their neighboring jurisdiction was being gored in some way with a state agency. So it's a complex environment and there were a lot of things to consider, but there may have been some opportunities lost. And for the state, for instance, the state had the statutory authority to intervene in situations of that kind and do the planning from the state level for the jurisdiction. If that ever happened, it was very seldom, once or twice maybe. So that that I think is maybe a bit of a chink, but it's not a. Sure, there's the authority for the commission to document and identify activities of statewide significance. Mm-hmm. In that regard, it's which has not been used very extensively either. And so some of the more intractable issues that local governments were faced with, maybe they could have been elevated into that category and dealt with. So in that regard, it wouldn't be so much a matter of like you were disciplining a delinquent child, if you will, but that you were recognizing something larger than that jurisdiction, and you were exercising a broader authority to deal with it. So that that may have reduced a little bit the effectiveness of what could have happened.
Yeah. Well, you've talked a little bit about disciplining certain jurisdictions as if maybe they're children. Or I'm curious if you think that the statewide planning goals have struck the right balance between state and local control that LCD originally intended in 1974.
Well, I don't know. I have a lot to add beyond what I just said. But I sometimes appreciate the fact that I, about myself, that I try to recognize context, complexity in situations. Again, I think, I'll go back and add a couple of things. I think if you look at today versus when Senate Bill 100 was passed and the program was started, I have doubts that we could do today what we did then, largely because of the fact that at that time there was a greater willingness to collaborate, to cooperate, to work across political lines and so forth, and there were some strong advocates on both sides of the political parties. Strong advocates that developed a goal, a dream, and they put the load on their shoulders and they stuck to it and they got it done. I don't think. There may be somebody out there today, some bodies, but haven't emerged in that way. But unless and until they do, I don't think we could do today what we did at that time. I think that carried through in the early years of LCDC as well. The members of the commission had similar stick-to-itiveness and strong convictions, and were people who, despite their views and their objectives, were able to work within a context of diversity and complexity. And people like you and I were talking a bit ago about Anne Squire. I think she contributed a lot to that. Shirley Anderson, Jim Smart on the agricultural side. Those are people who stood up kind of above the crowd and achieved what they set out to achieve, and that's very important. So I think the ability to look at complexity in that way and respond to this local state kind of dichotomy. You're not going to get a wholesale 100% one way or the other. Mm-hmm. The product that comes out is often going to not look like what you would ideally come up with if you just did it from a state perspective.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Well, this might be a good opportunity to discuss a little bit about what your role was at DLCD. You were field representative, is that correct?
Yeah, I guess I was. I would summarize that role as an eyes and ears kind of function. And it differed a little bit. Part of the time I was there, I was a staff coordinator for field reps around the state. And I, you know, looking back at that, and even at the time, I was aware that the challenges to the different field representatives was different because of where they were working, and the decision makers in some of the outlying parts of the state, the planners that were there may not have been as expert, or so the role of the field rep was kind of a teaching, kind of directing a little bit activity. In the Portland area, I had some pretty sophisticated dudes around, they knew the lay of the land. And so I think a lot of my job was that eyes and ears that I could pick up on the stuff that was happening at the state level that was kind of the hot buttons, mm-hmm. and so forth, and relay that to the local people. I could, I attended a lot of regional planners meetings and stuff, so I heard a lot of what was going on, the problems they were having, the kind of aspirations that were being put forward, and I could, from time to time, insert a little word of caution or do a heads up to my colleagues back in Salem. I took it as that kind of collaborative eyes and ears, being sensitive to what's going on.
Great.
Yeah.
I'm just wondering if you have any interesting anecdotes or experiences from that time, whether it's someone you worked with that was unique or whatnot that you maybe wanted to share.
Well, I've there was one occasion where Metro was this is after the boundary was established, where Metro was doing a boundary review process, and part of that, going back to my comments about inventories and projections and so forth, they wanted to get a projection of housing needs, mm-hmm. for the next 20 years. So they kicked that ball out to the jurisdictions and said, tell us what you think the needs are going to be in your location and what you think your capacity is to meet that need, realizing that there may be an overall regional estimate, and that could be distributed in different quantities and in different locations, kind of thing. So you may feel a need, but you really don't have the capacity for that for whatever reasons. In any event, in that exercise, David Knowles from the city of Portland was kind of ganged up on by some of the other planners when he came in with a pretty large number of housing units projected for the city of Portland. And the skeptics in the group said, "Oh, David, Portland will never meet up with that goal." and then Pearl District happened, et cetera, et cetera. So, and that, you know, so I've always appreciated David Knoll's experience in that regard. There was another kind of experience, just for the heck of it here. There was one time where some of my colleagues in the region didn't like the messaging that I was delivering to them and taking back. So they kind of queued on the QT, a couple of them from the same jurisdiction. A couple of them called Jim Ross, the director, and requested of him a lunch so they could sit down and talk about me. So Jim fielded that and said that he would do it. And then he called me up and said, "Hey, we have a lunch on such and such a day." So he took me to the lunch, and it was a nice, pleasant meal, but not much in the way of substantive stuff came out of it. That was an interesting time.
Well, I'm wondering, so what are the major strengths of SB 100, particularly in regard to the statewide planning goals and their relationship to the goals to local comprehensive plans? Do you think there has been any weaknesses or shortcomings that made drafting the goals of the program more difficult?
I don't know where I would go with that in particular beyond some of the things I've already said. Mm-hmm. Is that Henry Richmond, kind of the conversation I had with him was very emphatic about power is the right word, but of the authority of the state, when push came to shove, it was that availability of authority and the willingness on the part of some people in the process to utilize that. We may have had, again, at the early stages that was important. And we're not acting on it, are we? The lights keep on. That was really important to a certain extent at the outset. But I think as I discussed a little bit about complexity and cooperation and so forth, over time it really became important to. Realized that this railroad we were on had two rails, and there was always a need to synchronize in order to keep things on balance and moving forward.
Yeah. Well, and this can just be purely your own thoughts, but while we're on the topic of Henry Richmond, I know he had pushed on the national level for land use regulations similar to Oregon's. Why do you think that Oregon is somewhat unique in the way that we've been able to craft this program and it hasn't worked on the national level or maybe to the degree in other states?
Well, probably.
We're special?
No. In a sense, maybe. Well, for the same reason that I think it would be difficult to do today what happened then. I think Henry would kind of speak to this too, that it was the moment, mm-hmm. and it was the personalities, the people that were involved, and you take the litany of people, Tom McCall was a unique personality. The Republican McPherson was an insightful and dogged individual. And L.B. Day from the legislature was Oregon's example of a a big city politician. He was demonstrative. He was firm. He, to his credit, he listened. I recognize this. He would, at a commission meeting where their commission was being kind of batted around by home builders or whoever, he would listen, and then he had a way of putting a stop to it and moving on and saying, yeah, but this is the way it's going to be, kind of thing. So a lot of it was just the environment of the time. You know, I think it's significant when you look at that's in the Bill 100, one of the very first things that's mentioned kind of in the findings list up front is reference to uncoordinated use of land. It wasn't, Senate Bill 100 didn't emanate out of somebody's mind simply. It emanated out of people's observation of what was happening. And they had the, not only the ability to see that and to understand the difficulties with what was happening, but also to speak about it in a way that people can understand. McCall's term about subdivisions of, I can't remember the exact term, but he had a phrase that he used fairly recently, frequently about the scattered subdivisions.
Sagebrush, skip subdivisions.
Charbonneau, I think, was one of his examples. Here was this little city along a state highway, Wilsonville, and all of a sudden the population of Wilsonville is overshadowed by this huge development across the river, which was a state highway and a state bridge, and that put added pressure on the state system. In fact, one of the things that I was kind of amused about over the years was the number of times Wilsonville would come back to the table with a request for another interchange between the two existing interchanges. And ODOT would have to say, no, we can't do that, kind of stuff. Which is a good example, I think, of the support that the land use goals gave to other state agencies. They could talk technically about weave lanes because of the closeness of these interchanges, but they could also rely upon the state goal as further support for their saying no, kind of stuff. And I suspect Charbonneau might not have happened had the program been in place at the time somebody had the dream of building this large. And it's not just private developers. One of the other examples that popped up along the line was the PCC Rock Creek campus. It still sits out there, a bit of like a second thumb on your hand, out on the edge of the boundary. But it was way out, nothing urbanizing near to it at that time. And so it was that kind of thing, this uncoordinated use of land that, I think for all those kind of reasons, it fell together, it came together at that time. We lack, as I've indicated, I think we lack the leadership to do that today. But I do think, going to your quip about special, that There is something about the environmental consciousness of people. We're still the stepchild of Seattle or San Francisco, and so there's something about us that causes that. And so I think from that point of view, something more like 100 could emanate today, but it would still take the leadership to bring that together.
Mm-hmm. Well, we're on the, more of the political bent at the moment. I'm just wondering if there are any particular prominent state and elected local officials or ballot measures or even, you know, actions by the Oregon legislature that has advanced or undercut the purposes of SB 100. We've had many ballot measures over the years, and just wondering if there was any one in particular that you think really struck to the heart of it.
Well, I've already talked a little bit about some of the strong personalities. I think I'm mentioning the startup of the LCDC and the gold adoption process. I think Arnold Kogan was the right man at the right moment to realize that to move this thing forward, you couldn't just sit in the office and expect it to happen. You had to get out and mix with the people and get after it. I think it was also in talking with Arnold instructive about how he came on the scene out of the Port of Portland and some of the industrial planning that they did for the port properties, and that was picked up by Ed Westerdahl and others and relayed to Governor McCall. So the type of thing that the port was doing with regard to its special interest and its properties became a bit of a model or a facsimile of what could happen in other respects in the state and the region. So that they were important. I think the ballot measures, even though they were defeated, kind of put a cloud of danger overhead and said, you got to recognize the complexity. You got to travel both rails of the road, or the next time. Next time it might be different, kind of thing. I do think people like Chandler, what's his first name?
John
Chandler from the home builders, as you know, in one sense, I think he was a good example of somebody with a mission and a point of view, who listened and cooperated. He could rise above the parochial interest and look at the larger picture and maneuver his way into a place that was acceptable to him and his constituency, but didn't totally upset the apple cart for everybody else that was involved.
Well, it's been 40 plus years now. Is the system itself prepared for some of the challenges that you might see or that we see here in the future?
I alluded to one phenomenon a bit ago, but I'd take up in response to that. I think the climate change situation is one that warrants us thinking carefully about maybe it's time or near time to generate and a Senate Bill 100 type response. I think it's endemic to the climate change situation worldwide that there is, that we face the prospect of significant population distribution, where coastal areas, areas prone to desertification, are going to uplift people and move them in search of other places. And that, and as we were talking about Oregon a while ago, I think Oregon becomes, if you think about it, we're kind of in that temperate zone between the south and the north. Mm-hmm. And so it's natural that people would orient kind of to that circumstance. And if heat and whatever else drought water conditions get in the way of life and for people in California, Oregon is pretty attractive, and it stands to be attractive, relatively speaking, for some time to come. So I think we really need to think carefully about what those kind of changes will mean to us. If some of our strong advocates are already complaining about densification, and if we're already being singled out as being among the worst in traffic congestion, it ain't going to get any better with large populations coming in. And so I think we have the makings of an environment that is similar to Senate Bill 100's uncoordinated use of land examples that people will respond to. We have a reason to be thoughtful about this. And from my perspective, what I said earlier about crafting your habitat in a reasonable, balanced, comprehensive fashion, that challenge is still there, because that habitat can get despoiled pretty quickly if it's not continually tended with. So, and related to that, probably one of the most significant specific items is water. I think that's an activity of statewide significance that ought to be seized on right now, and a good broad public exercise undertaken to adequately plan for water, and not the least of the issue, all of the issues involved in that, are the privatization of water to avoid industry trying to take over that, because the more precious and limited it becomes, the more incentive and the more sense of profit potential is going to be there for private interest. And I think one of the worst things that could happen in the region is to have the public put on the sideline with regard to that resource. So that's an activity that I think is there's a lot of been a lot of concern about the movement of oil by train around the that's another activity of statewide significance, and I'm not so sure about what even some of my old colleagues in the transportation department might feel relieved if they weren't almost solely looked upon as the good guy or the bad guy or the regulator to take care of that issue. I think it needs to be elevated into a broader discussion and find a strategy for dealing with that issue. Kind of related to the water situation, if the extent to which agriculture still plays a significant role economically for us, if we need the water issue becomes not just in the broad sense, but specifically for agriculture because of the extent of its use of water. Mm-hmm. We need to enter ag production into that equation and protect our water supply by being more efficient in the use of agricultural water, which we made, I think, over the years, some good progress at. I remember as a kid going into my grandfather's farm in Colorado and watching my uncle, who worked on the farm with him, irrigating corn. Big furrows, and they just run water into the furrows, which had to be a massive waste of water, kind of thing. We don't do that kind of thing anymore. Sprinkle and it comes down and wets what needs to be wet, and the corn is planted closer together, so that mm-hmm. you get. So there's a lot of things that have gone on, but those seem to me to be some issues looking to the future that perhaps Senate Bill 100 or its amendments can address.
We have about 10 or 15 minutes left. Are there any other topics or anecdotes that you'd like to discuss? This is an opportunity for your thoughts into, you know, perpetuity. Mm-hmm.
I guess on the question of major strengths of Senate Bill 100, mm-hmm. I think it's a strength that they set up a statewide commission, and that they gave that commission the ability to make state law. I think that's. I don't know state government from top to bottom, but that's at least a rarity, if not the sole example of a state commission exercising that kind of authority. And the commission always had that, like I said earlier, have at least one eye towards the legislature, because the legislature could trump what they were doing. The commission, nonetheless, vis-a-vis local governments in particular, or special interest groups, had considerable authority that people had to, in the long run, account for and be cognizant of. So, mm-hmm. I think that was important. I mentioned Chandler a while ago. There were other home builder people who were they weren't Chandlers, but they were strong advocates for the development community, and I think they were very effective in making their interests and their needs known. I do think it was beneficial that they learned all of Chandler to give and take in the process, and that that was important. I think to some extent that modeled for some of the other special interest folk a way to behave or a way to engage or not engage. The Farm Bureau was always kind of an enigma, in a way, is that they could, for those farmers among the people in the larger farm community, who didn't want to lose the opportunity for the next subdivision, farmland. But as long as they were serious about farming, they had to be cognizant of the help that they were getting from Goal 3 in the state program. So they, you know, they played this sometimes both sides of the road approach to things, but in the, usually in the final analysis, you know, they could at least be silenced, mm-hmm. if not become an advocate. But it's another example, I think, on the farm thing that signifies the importance of a James Smart at the beginning, because he could really drive that serious farmer's interest and embed it into the program. But as he passed on, a lot of that clear focus passed on. So Ron Eber became a sort of a surrogate for a strong farmer, because Ron took up that cause a lot and always kept himself informed enough, mm-hmm. that it was difficult for any opposition just to blow things by him or by the commission who was being counseled by Ron's efforts. So Ron was pretty instrumental in. I forgot the question now.
It was just the opportunity to share anything else that you'd like to. Well, we've been speaking today with Jim Sitzman, who has had quite the experiences in land use, from the Columbia Region Association of Governments to the Department of Land Conservation and Development. Jim, it's been a pleasure today. If you have anything else you'd like to add?
No, not really. I guess in closing, I would caution again that we need to be aware of those unintended consequences and stay ahead of the game, so that we're anticipating things like reaction to density and mm-hmm. traffic congestion and being proactive to deal with them before they become the rallying cry for the next ballot measure.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Great. Well, thank you very much.
Thank you. Yeah.